Lefty. He was the only puppy in the litter to survive. He's a Swiss Mountain Dog. He's 2 years old. He was just neutered a couple weeks ago.
They died of puppies?
They all died except for him.
Puppies died?
Mm-hmm. And even he had some sort of an infected eye, and it was removed when he was like a couple weeks old. Mm-hmm.
So he grew up with the parents just until 8 weeks by himself?
Yeah, they took him home at 12 weeks. So, very friendly guy, but he's just a total bulldozer. The husband pretty much said he can handle him. However, the wife and the daughter are like, we can't walk him. He's just crazy all the time. They've taught him a couple commands, but he doesn't listen. He's so easily distracted. There's a yellow lab in the house that he just... Very friendly yellow lab, but the guy was like, the yellow lab's really going to appreciate him being gone because he's just crazy.
All right.
Yeah, he's a jumper, he's a puller.
Is he again?
He's two.
Okay.
He so does what he wants when he wants. He knows he can use his weight. Didn't care at all about his owner leaving. He lifted his leg 20 feet high to mark.
Okay.
First thing he did was drag his owner to a tree.
He didn't have any competition, even up to 8 weeks
at all. Nope. All the puppies died. Yep.
Wow. Interesting.
All the puppies died. So he's just... All right. he's a big goof, is what he is.
Okay. You goof? Yes, you are. What's that? What is it? What is it? Oh, ooh. Oh.
He whined for a couple minutes in the car, and then he just laid down and was quiet. But then he whined again when I parked.
It takes too much energy. It takes too much energy to keep whining. What's his name?
Lefty.
Lefty. Lefty. Lefty. Come here. Lefty, come here. Hi. How are you? Hi. All right. Come here, Lefty. Hi. How are you? I don't know. You live with another dog?
Yeah, a very friendly 4-year-old yellow lab who tolerates him.
Break.
Yeah.
Come. Hi.
Thank goodness he's friendly. He's a big guy.
Good. Really. See, that's why he has the dynamic of wanting to have a position in the hierarchy where he contributes to the protection and whatnot. Right?
Mm-hmm.
You can see it.
Yep.
It's, you know, good.
It's your kind of guy.
But he doesn't really know what he's doing. He's been living in Neverland forever.
He's just been ruling
Good. The
house.
But it's like ruling a cushy, easy environment. You're not ruling an environment where there's competition.
Yes.
So you get this false confidence, I believe. You know, I pushed him a little bit here to see what he would do. I can tell this is his first time having a dynamic with a living thing that he can't just jump on and paw at and bark at. He has to have some respect for it. So some light bulbs are going off for him now. So I'll be the model of how he should be treating his humans.
Just the fact that he's still right now is amazing.
Yeah.
Ooh, begging for attention.
That's how I thought.
Demanding some pets.
No, this is a learning lesson. You see, you guys, you're on dog's time. So there's a lot of silence and there's a lot of just good. So he offered that. I know he's good. He wants to be a right-hand man. You can feel it. You know, he's two. He's an adult. He's like, I'm a right-hand man. He's like, well, you're making a lot. You got bad judgment. You're making a lot of bad choices. So hopefully, this process will not only train him, it'll teach him the relationship of where he stands with his humans and in his home so that he's not feeling the need to to chime up inappropriately and guard the house and guard the people, or alert bark at everything, or even on a simpler level, you can't just pick up in this environment and do whatever you want anymore, okay? You have to be a follower. And if a follower is given freedom, then yeah, go ahead. If I say you're free, do whatever, go ahead. But a follower also listens when we say, hey, calm down, go relax. And that is beautiful, isn't it? Go relax, there's things going on, and we just need you over there. Good. This is the beginning. It starts with our relation, right? These walls aren't going to train him, right? I'm in the environment, and I guess I'm technically an environmental that's starting to shift him. It's the first relationship that is setting very clear and effective boundaries. And that's why he's holding still, because all that moving around got him corrected. The barking and all that stuff. So he's kind of just being quiet and laying, and he's noticing, that's what I like. That's what I like.
He's two, but he feels like a puppy.
I was going to say that. That's why I asked his age, because I would... These, you know, these breeds can be big, so I thought he was like maybe a big puppy, like 6 months to a year. His attitude feels like 6 months.
He can't hold still. You know, he's jumping, he's pulling.
And he's two.
He's begging you for pets.
So he's been stunted by a comfy bubble,
mm-hmm.
right? His development isn't there because he hasn't had the proper aversives to develop him, right? An aversive with, let's say, you know, another dog in him, which he didn't have. He was a single dog. He was a solo pup, so he didn't even have competition within his pack. And then when he lives with humans, maybe there is a little bit with the husband. He said he has a little bit more control with the others, but it's still not enough where the dog's gonna, you know, off leash, do everything. He hasn't been a follower to dogs or humans, really. I mean, he left at 8 weeks, and he only had his parents, probably just the mom he interacted with. So submission's in there already. It's just a natural choice that they choose, but they usually choose flight and fight first, and that can look different for each dog, right? So he went through that cycle in this particular ritual here. He chose flight, but we have the recall, so it didn't work. He chose his version of fight, which is just like kind of throwing a fit. He didn't attack me or anything. Some dogs will try to attack you or anything close. Just out of like last ditch effort, flight didn't work, use fight. It's just part of the process. And then if they come to and everything calms down and those choices are now, they don't see as valuable, they start to choose submission with a little guidance from us, and then that becomes valuable because all of a sudden the conversation's over. Oh, we're done, that's it? Oh, okay. And now we have to apply that to every post-correction, that state of mind, which is just calm and submissive, right? But in order to get there, every dog's gonna have their version of flight. And sometimes you won't even see that because the dog's so good at active ignoring, they don't even get to the point of running away. But then if you try to grab them, they run away. If for some reason that dog can't get away and you keep putting pressure on them, that's where you see the fight, whether it's just literally like a toddler breakdown or it's aggression. Right? Either way, it's fight, and then submission comes if you know how to follow through. So it's part of the process. So he did that in his own way, which again, he feels immature. He feels like 6 months, and so did in his fight. Luckily, it didn't feel like a dog coming at me. That he didn't know. It's like he doesn't know he can bite or anything yet. You know, I think he had some ideas of putting his teeth on me at one point, but then he second-guessed himself. And when he second-guessed himself, there was a little bit of submission. Then showed a little bit of softness. So he's starting to realize, oh, if I start to get that way, then he'll get that way. But if I soften, he'll soften. So he's seeing his behavioral choices is going to affect the outcome now. It's really going to affect, because in modern homes, a lot of these dogs, and you're not, and you're included, a lot of the, we make sure it's kind of bubble wrapped, where it's like, there is no confrontation, there is no conflict. We keep them away from aversives the best we can. And then we kind of keep a puppy mentality into the adulthood, and then they become more intense, and then we have to have training. But so what would some natural world confrontations be in conflict that he would have ran into if he lived in a different environment? One would have been just like him annoying. That's a big one. Like if he annoys another dog or a human who lived in this way, he'd get corrected for that. So moving around too much gets corrected. Barking and whining chronically gets corrected. Also over resources, so that he would then a hierarchy is formed, right? By raising them that way and having those conversations productively, then you have a follower out of that. With the lack of those, we just have a dog doing his thing and we're doing our thing, and sometimes they come together if he finds it in his best interest. But other than that, he's kind of doing his own thing and just kind of using the humans to get what he needs. But then he's not going to give a certain level of submission, because that isn't just given. The dog doesn't give that as a gift. That is something that you have to earn. It's wired in them to figure out the pecking order so that the top dog, if you will procreate. So it's no difference when they get into the humans hierarchy. They'll give you some submission if you get it from them, but they're not going to give you 100% just because you get a little. So just because you can make him wait for his food or something doesn't mean he's going to walk nice for you. Going after the full follower, it's like a pie, right? Each experience we're getting a little bit, and I just know the experiences that I need to get to complete the pie so that I have a follower. You might have some. You might have 25% of that pie, and you're like, okay, it's decent. Maybe you even have 75% of the pie, but still, 25%, he's not committed. And we know what that feels like. Then you're going to have bumps in the road. So this boils down to creating a follower and getting those commands nice and tight so that he's easy to move around the world. Right? Look, you've learned a lot already. He's quiet.
He's acting like he's listening to your lecture.
I know. Good boy, huh? So we'll keep going here. It's very good. So a lot of attention on me.
I've never seen him look at a human so much in the time I've known him.
And there's a lot of reinforcers because he really does enjoy, being pet and told he's doing good. So he's like, okay, now he's in the phase, because we've had our disagreement, we've had the submission. Now he's in the phase of like, okay, what is it that he wants? He's making document right now, so I have a window of opportunity to show him. He says, what is it that he wants and what is it that he doesn't like? So he's kind of just walking around a little bit more on eggshells saying, is this okay? Is this okay? I will lead him through experiences that will show him exactly the dynamic. We need to have resources in this room that we can then talk about, like who gets access to them. And one of the big ones is going to be other dogs. So first thing I want to do is bring in somebody not threatening, like a little female dog. And we'll see where it goes, because it's a dance. Whatever he does, I will then counter or whatever. We will then figure it out. But my main goal is to get him away from the dogs and also claim the dogs if he shows interest so that he can see that I can do that with him, but then also show him that I can control those dogs. So he sees I can control the pack and him. That must equal leader. And that pie I was talking about, right there, it gets like half full after that one. It's like half the work's done. The rest is like, you can't run away even when it feels like you can. It's like, okay, check another 25% on that. You have to stay. So we're going to get, but half of it, I swear to God, it's like half or even more, is just he believes that I'm leader material. Doesn't mean he's not going to try to buck the system a few times while I close in that pie and get 100% follower. But it does mean that my job's going to be so much easier when she sees this little thing here. So it's something they do amongst each other. If dogs all get in this room and they don't know each other, they're going to go through it right away and figure it out. They're going to try to hump each other. They're going to try to bully each other just to start getting that pecking order, just so everybody can settle down and relax. They need to know. So that's what we're going to do, except I'm going to be a human doing it with them. Okay? Izzy first.
Izzy, baby, Izzy, Izzy, hi.
Break.
Yeah, good boy, Lassie. She's intimidated by his size.
Yeah. She's doing good though. I got her back. Good. You're good. Good. That right there is going to get you in trouble.
Yeah, that's a little microcosm. That little head. Closed mouth.
It's in the breed. At least one of them, the Roddy, that's in there. Yeah, that's what's fighting there. There it is. I see it. See, it's real now because I'm adding a pack dynamic and I'm starting to limit the movements. This is where you see the real like the thing is, when I'm saying real, I mean like the animalistic part of his brain. They're really good at living with people, but when they click into like reality, the natural world, I'm talking to that part of his brain and I'm saying, I want to have certain conversations with that part of the brain so that he doesn't turn them on. So that in the future, he's like, with my human, I don't turn on any of those drives as far as like territorial stuff towards me, trying to correct me for correcting him, all that stuff. He's learning as me being a model that he doesn't do that to his humans. But unfortunately for me or any trainer, you have to go through that. You can't, if you bypass it, it's still in there. You haven't addressed it and it will come out, okay? And it's always when it's inconvenient. So I'm talking to him about those things because he's already thinking, there you go, that's better, a little more submission. But he's already being dominant with me, all right? It's not good to be dominant to your handler or to your owner. So he's learning that conversation. If he didn't show that sign, we wouldn't be talking right now about this. That's fine. That's fine. Uh-uh. Don't do this at home. Teach him how to submit. That's why you see people walk into dogs like this. He needs to learn. There it is. Okay, so I'm not saying run away from me. That's flight. I'm definitely not saying fight me. What's the other one? These are like micro submissions. It's not like a full submission where he's on his side. It's just like he surrendered a little bit. So I said, that's the answer by relieving the pressure of my presence towards him, right? I was very much asking him to do something. I became more assertive, meaning I'm not being like setting up boundaries like don't jump on me. I'm being more assertive, like saying do something. I don't like what you're doing right now, do something else. He did something else, which is take a back seat. I walk away from him. And then I'll turn around and say, good boy. And start saying to that part of the brain, I like that, I like that. But that dominance that he showed right there in that little bit, that needs to be addressed for certain. Which we just did. Come. Good boy, come on. That's it. Come here. There you are. Hi, big guy. How are you? Is he out? Good. Out. Yeah. Good. Just making sure you're not spooked. That's good. Good. This will come back once I get Riggy out here. Good. What?
It's all instinct, because he really doesn't know what he's doing.
Yeah. I'm talking to the dog, like I'm talking to the dog part of him, I'm not talking to Lefty, you know what I mean? It's not like the persona that he has that we've seen, the goofy and all that. I'm just not even talking to that right now. I'm talking to the Rottweiler, I'm talking to the, what else is it?
Mastiff, St. Bernard.
I'm talking to the part of the brain.
Bernays Mountain Dog.
That will go there and showing him the relationship in humans, there's no room for that. Okay, but he's giving me looks. The looks that he's giving me are fighting words in the dog world. Okay, so the look that he gave me, if another dog had my temperament, they would, in order to correct him, it would be a fight. They try to mount him, and if he threw a fit, it would be a fight. He's giving me looks like, you know, he's thinking about fighting me over my behavior, which is, I'm doing certain things intentionally. Good, and when he shows me softness,
you can see when something. The mouth is open, he's softer, looser. Yeah.
You see all that?
Yep.
Good, yeah. But look at how much softer mm-hmm. he was with it. It's not just that he was looking at me because he's looking at me there, but he's looking at me like this.
Yeah.
That's fine. I'm saying that part of the brain is welcome. The other part where you started to do the shift, I can read every little bit. He probably doesn't not used to people calling it out because maybe they can't see that little shift. He gives that little shift and I'm like, whoa, because I know where that's going. I know what that leads to. That leads to all the stuff we're complaining about. Good. Basically, dominance aggression is he's willing to correct me for telling him what to do or for doing something that he doesn't like. You know, if I'm like, hey buddy, can I brush you? And he's like, I don't like that, boom. It's not that I don't like you, it's that I don't like that. Or he'll correct me for correcting him, right? It's not personal, he's, you know, I'm just gonna bite your face off real quick, and then it's not personal, it's just, I'm being dominant when you try to get me to do something I don't like. And that's where we see dominant aggression. So it's not like he's doing this out of fear. He's doing this to keep his position of all the wonderful freedom and resources he has right now. Like Julie said, he's king. So if I come in, naturally, if another dog comes in this room, they're gonna sniff, right? And then they're gonna try to honk, or it's gonna turn into a fight. Why? Why? They don't even know each other. Because if one dog can win that conversation, if you will, win it, then they've already settled who gets access to the resources. So they don't have to do it necessarily when the resource is there, unless they both want to bad enough and do that again. If he loses, right, he'll know that that dog can do that, so they'll stand back and let that dog have first access. So when I'm meeting him, I brought a dog in here and started the conversation. I am stimulating that part of the brain. When I come back here and I do a little puff of air like that, don't do that. You can get bit right in the face, right? But as a dog fight can occur as soon as the dog tries to sniff, it's stimulating a dog going back there and sniffing, and then he's starting to turn on that dominant side. And then I look him in the eyes and I say no. And when I say no, what do you do next? Do you submit or do you try to fight through it? Right? So that's what we're looking for. That's what really matters. That's why he's not listening. Right there. We haven't had this ritual yet. We haven't had it yet. And if somebody has, I mean, then I wouldn't be here probably. Because it's not hard to teach the commands. But it is hard to get that to not be a bite, right? And we're talking about a friendly dog, but we know how to access that part of the brain whenever we want. Get dogs in here, they go into the natural world. They're out of human fluffy world. I'm out of human world, I'm in dog world. And then the human steps in with the right touch and understands the right angle to approach it. And he sees me as a dog, as a competing dog for the top position, and he starts treating me that way, and then he learns that humans can do it too, and he learns a lot. He learns my way of correcting on the e-collar, what it looks and feels like, and he also learns how to get out of the confrontation, right? The alternative is submission. We don't have to fight at all. Just submit. And what's submission? It's just giving up that position of trying to be dominant and fight for your free will, if you will, and be a follower. Meaning, just listen. Right? Good. There was bites in that brain. Did you see it?
Yeah, I did. He might not know.
It's not lefty.
Yep.
Right?
He might not know what he's doing, but something instinctually is saying, if it comes down to it.
Because we set up the right conversation. Yes. We set up the conversation that dogs set up with each other mm-hmm. upon meeting each other for the first time.
Yep.
Why do dogs do that? Why don't they shake hands and have a dinner first and get to know each other? They go right for the crotch. If there's any tension, it's right to a fight. If there's no tension, it's push it further, see if we can dominate, see if we can hump. We're able to trigger that conversation to see what the dog really is upstairs. Not lefty, not how he's learned to cope with humans and get by the day just fine, which he hasn't, by the way.
He wouldn't be here.
But we're looking at the brain. Yeah, he wouldn't be here if he did fit in well. So what I was going to say is, I can't remember. I was headed somewhere with it. Oh yeah. You said something that I thought was interesting. It's something that is kind of silly, but it also feels to have some truth to it, which is like when we have these back and forth with a dog and the dog decides to flee and then fight and then submit, when that's all over and the dog's relaxed, you've said multiple times, you're like, it's like an exorcism.
Yeah.
Because you see the dog go through all of the bad parts of the brain. When I say bad parts, I mean the parts that we're trying to get the dog to not express while living in a human's world, not the natural world. All that stuff, that fighting, that barking, that all that stuff, the flee, the panic. We have to go through it so that they can learn you don't have to do any of that. All you have to do is submission. That's why you see the dogs looking good, because they learn submission. And then that's applied to every post-correction, because it's associated with the stimulation on the collar, okay, to submit. So after we correct, via it's a dog doing something wrong, or it's a dog not complying to a command, we get that submissive mind, that calm mind. That's why the dogs look good, and they feel good, they just chill, right? But that doesn't mean we can't say break. They also know when you say break and you say go have it, they'll use some of their drive if you allow it. all right, they're not going to stay like this, but it's like that calm on command, right? Like, I'll be able to then take this state of mind and shh, when I shush, I want that state of mind, which usually goes along with relaxing the body, but the dogs can learn this. It's amazing. Because you're saying, none of the resources are for you, be passive, everything's for me right now, and this is what I want, quietness. Even when I'm dealing with the door, even when they just go. And then when they do it, because they have the ability to turn around, we say, that was awesome. You're a great companion. And now they learn where they are, okay? But like this exorcism or whatever, it's just the dog going through flight and fight, and then submission, and then we have the benefits of that. And then we can give them the right experiences to shape them in a way where they understand this submission is valuable, which is just following. It just means submitting to the fact that you're going to be led by a human. That's what I mean by submission. Submission means I have decided that I'm going to allow this human to lead me. Okay? That's how you get submissions. That's not the only ritual, but it's a really important one. There's also going to be some other rituals with recall and stays where he understands the boundaries. And if they want to fight because they want to be able to run away, they'll try that. If they want to fight because they, you know, and I mean going through flight and fight, going through that natural process before submission. For their stay commands, they'll do that. They'll go through it. But then when it's done, it's over and everybody's enjoying themselves, even the dog, because now they're a follower and they get to do more because they listen and they have a bigger life and everybody's happy. But living with a dog who still is willing to be dominant towards their humans or even just neglect listening to them is not 100% follower, which is going to lead to hiccups on a daily basis, and they can be minor or they can be major. Okay, good. And I think this guy is a nice guy, but what happens with a guy like this is I think something dangerous is coming this guy's way, and I don't know if he's going to do harm to somebody, whether it be being too friendly and knocking them down, or if he's going to get himself harmed by running away or something. But he is, as of right now or before training, a liability to himself and others, even though he's nice and friendly. Although we've seen in the brain, when we start to get to where we're going, we see the brain start to shift to bite. It's natural. How does he respond when I say no to bite? That's more important than him thinking about biting. How do you respond when I correct you for thinking about biting? Do you then let it go and submit? Cool, then we're gonna be fine. Or do you want to push through that and fight me to whatever level to maintain that, okay? That's the temperament. Now, I don't see him, if he does have a little fight in him, I don't see him doing it more than once. He's a sweet guy for the most part. Yeah, but we like to check, good. See how he's letting me do that? That's him doing his best to be soft with me. Good, so I'm letting you know I like that. And here's the thing, though, I was like, they know that. It's just that it's not a conversation that we have with them daily, which we should. Is how you behaving in the room that I'm in and within my personal space, like within a couple feet bubble of me. How is your energy and stuff? How should you be behaving around me? See, all that stuff, good. He just hasn't had this done before. Good boy, good. That's very nice.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I wasn't expecting him to do that. It's a nice lefty. Oh yeah.
He's beautiful.
He's a very, very pretty boy. Okay. So what's awesome about this and a guy like him is like now that I'm going through this, it won't come up. Like that's the beauty. Like me and once it's done, I can already tell with him that it's like once it's done, he's just going to be like, you're my guy. And then that's it. And, but it's sort of the natural to kind of go through that back and forth to figure out who can tell who what to do.